Hey guys, Hello Bella here. In this video, I'm going to be exploring a concept called cognitive distortions. And this is basically just thought patterns that cause us to view reality in a way that is inaccurate. It may be overly negative, it may be very critical, or we may even find some own errors of our own thinking that cause us to kind of interpret the world incorrectly. And it leads to a lot of anxiety and depression. Before I get into this subject, I will note that I am not a therapist, I'm not licensed, I'm not a medical professional, I'm just a person who is exploring these concepts on my own, so please don't take any of this as medical advice. One of the main reasons that I feel qualified to talk about this is because learning about it has really changed the way that I go through my life. I was a person who has childhood PTSD, which is CPTSD for those of you who don't know, and I've read so many self-help books and done so much inner work that I feel like this is something that is worth sharing with other people. A concise way of looking at cognitive distortions would be these are habitual errors in thinking. So things that we think over and over again that sort of get reinforced because we keep thinking about them, we keep believing these things to be true, and eventually it just kind of warps our perception of reality. One of the key components is that these distortions are usually negative. For instance, if I text my best friend and she doesn't text me back and I start to assume maybe she's mad at me, maybe she got into a car accident, maybe there's something wrong, that would be basically catastrophizing the situation. So there are anywhere between 10 to 20 different cognitive distortions that people can exhibit, but I'm not going to go through them in a list because there's a lot of YouTube videos that already do this. I would recommend that you print out a list of the cognitive distortions and kind of go through that list one by one and see which ones of those you identify with. Maybe try to write out some examples of the ones that make the most sense to you. But for me, I'm definitely big on overgeneralizing things, like saying, well, I always mess up or I always do this. And another one that was an issue for me was the all or nothing thinking. Some people call it black and white thinking, but it's basically like, for instance, if I meal prepped a bunch of food and I, instead of eating the food that I meal prepped, maybe I just go through the Chick-fil-A drive-thru and I say, well, I have failed my diet. But in reality, I didn't really fail my diet, right? It's all or nothing. You didn't fail just because you ate one bad meal, but that all or nothing thinking causes us to get into a loop of feeling bad about ourselves or overgeneralizing something so much that we think we shouldn't even begin to try in the first place to improve our situation. One thing that really clicked for me was that cognitive distortions often come from people who had traumatic childhoods or like adverse childhood experiences. So things that happened to you when you were younger that you really couldn't control. And now these things have put you on edge so much that you are feeling like you need to control everything. You know, you might feel like you're almost like hyper aware, hyper vigilant of what is going on. And so you're always looking for something to happen, always looking for the other shoe to drop. There are actually some theories that say that we developed cognitive distortions as a means of survival. Basically, if you think about it as we're all hunter-gatherers and we're all animals hunting other animals, then whenever we see something that could be a potential threat, we want to see it as the most threatening thing possible. That way we stay alive and we assess the threat. One example I can think of is whenever my dogs hear something outside, they usually go crazy, they bark, they make a lot of noise, they run to the door. They are assessing the threat as something that is serious and real, and they think it is the worst case scenario every single time, even though it's usually just like a package being delivered. So that is kind of one way of looking at it. Like, we can kind of see things really, really through this lens of negativity. If you're familiar with the concept of rose-colored glasses, cognitive distortions are basically gray, cloud-colored glasses. Everything is negative. Everything is bad. Of the 10 cognitive distortions, I think that one of the ones that we probably all do is mind reading. So this is when we assume that we know what other people are thinking. And let's just face it, this is impossible, right? There's no way for me to know what my mom is thinking, what my cousin's thinking, what my friend's thinking. We can kind of have a vague idea, but until we actually speak to that person and we ask them what they're thinking or feeling, it's sort of impossible. Assuming what other people are thinking usually leads down a road that is not productive, because you could have just asked the person, and sometimes we can go spin a web of things that we think are true that are not necessarily true, which just gets us back into that overall feedback loop of assuming something that is not true, like an error in thinking. Another distortion is personalization, which is the concept that everything is about me and this is my fault. Or for instance, if you go to a restaurant and the server is rude to you and doesn't really fulfill your wishes or doesn't bring you a refill or whatever you want, and they're just kind of snotty to you, you think, well, what did I do to her to make her act like that towards me? Or does she know something about me? Does she not like me? I don't understand why she would do this to me. The key concept here is to me. So we assume that this is personal when in fact it's not really personal. You could have just caught her on a really bad day, a really hard shift, and she's just not feeling it. She's not in a good headspace, and you know, she may have taken some of that out on you. So personalization would be thinking that we are personally responsible for things that are happening to us. And the key concept here is that it is happening to us. We are not doing it, we're not controlling it. Another example of personalization could be, say you applied for a job. The job had 10 applicants, and so you only have a 10% chance of getting the job to begin with, and you don't get the job, which is a statistical probability, and you think, they must not have liked me. I must have done something wrong. I was not a good candidate for this job because I'm an idiot and I can't possibly do this job and I'm not going to find any other jobs. This is sort of that cognitive distortion pairing. Labeling is something that we do, like calling yourself an idiot, calling yourself fat, calling yourself stupid, calling yourself a failure. All of those are labels that we put on ourselves, and those are distortions that we tend to believe about ourselves. For instance, if you call yourself fat every single day and you say, oh, I'm so fat, and you know, you identify as a fat person, well, you're probably going to fulfill that prophecy of continuing to eat like a fat person. Same as if you said, well, I'm just a forgetful person, I just forget everything. Well, you're not really going to make an attempt to plan things, you're going to probably not be organized, and you're just going to buy into this idea that you are a forgetful person. So the label in itself is a negative label, and you attach yourself to it and you believe that the label is true. Another cognitive distortion is called disqualifying the positive. So this means that we are tending to see the bad things in a situation. For instance, if my business makes $100,000 this year, instead of saying, oh, I did a great job, you know, I've really raised my sales, I've made more money this year. Yeah, but you know, you still have to pay taxes on that money, and you still have to set aside some money for growing your business next year. So really, you didn't make $100,000. This is disqualifying the positives. Another example could be, okay, let's say that you cleaned your whole kitchen, like top to bottom, spotless. Like you cleaned the cabinets, you cleaned the floor, you cleaned all your dishes, you wiped down all your countertops, you even cleaned the inside of the microwave, as disgusting as it was. And you get all of that done, and you say, okay, yeah, but like I didn't clean the rest of the house, I still have that to do. Like, instead of celebrating the win, instead of looking at something good, you chose to focus all your energy and attention into what you didn't do. And this would be disqualifying the positive. The last cognitive distortion that I'm going to touch on is should statements. And should statements are those things that we all tell ourselves, like, man, I really should work out. Man, I really should start eating better. Man, I should go back to school. This is a famous quote, don't should all over yourself. So basically what that means is that all of this just leads to guilt. It isn't motivating, right? It isn't motivating at all to be thinking about all the things you need to do. If I sat down right now and thought about all that I needed to do, I would just have to stop making this video. Like, I would not be able to sit down and think about the concepts of cognitive distortions, because I would be thinking about, oh, well, I have laundry to do. I have to prep for tomorrow. I still need to work out today. It's gonna get dark soon. I need to vacuum. All of these little things that kind of like, yeah, I should do them, but is shooting myself really helping the situation right now? It doesn't get any of those things done to say I should do them, right? So either do them or put it off for another time and don't really worry about it too much. All these cognitive distortions really lead to an increase of anxiety. And of course, anxiety's cousin, depression, can come into play here. So I think it's very important to sort of look at these and kind of study them a little bit and find a resource that you can kind of check up on yourself. Like, say, is this actually true? Is what I'm saying real, or is this just the way that I'm interpreting it? Did I really fail here, or is this just a minor setback? Am I personally to blame for my company not making enough money this year and not meeting our sales quota? Or am I just part of the bigger picture, and as a company as a whole, we have to work harder next year in order to meet our goals? Is this a belief that I'm carrying with me from my childhood in order to continue to protect myself, even though this belief is no longer serving me? Am I so comfortable with the concept of failure that it's all I can relate to, it's all I can cling to? Now, obviously, these examples may seem a little extreme or maybe even a little silly to you, but that's kind of what cognitive distortions are. They are our beliefs that we believe that are true, even though they're not true. One of the suggestions that is commonly given for cognitive distortions is to check the facts. So if you are having all these thoughts, maybe check what is actually true. Like, what can you validate? What do you know is a fact? And then what is just a belief that you cannot really validate? You just don't really know why you feel it. You just feel it. I think it's super important to be aware of these, but also to be gentle with yourself. We do not have the ability to overcome every traumatic thing that has ever happened to us overnight. It is a process. It is something that I have been working on literally for a decade, and it's still difficult for me to talk about certain things. It's still hard for me to celebrate my wins. It's hard for me to not see the negatives, because for so long, I could only see the negatives. So now that I'm an adult, I'm having to relearn what it looks like to see the positives, to assume that everything is going to be okay, to not personalize everything. And I think that this is something that is a practice. It's just like meditation. You know, you don't get good at it overnight. Simply noticing your thoughts and the thought patterns that you have is really the first step to overcoming these cognitive distortions. Hopefully this video is not too long, you guys. I did have a printout of cognitive distortions, and if you Google cognitive distortions, you can find a couple different lists. And my advice to you would be to print out the list and then maybe tape it to a page in your journal or something like that, or even like put it on your refrigerator or something, somewhere that you'll read it and you'll kind of be reminded of it. And then as you're going about your daily life, you can kind of say, okay, well, that was labeling, or that was all or nothing thinking, or that was overgeneralization, or I think I was catastrophizing that situation. And you'll be amazed at just how much knowing about the concept of cognitive distortions can just help you in your life to kind of overcome some of this negative thinking. So thanks so much for watching, guys. I hope that you have a great week, and I will catch you in the next video.